It's lovely to see so many kids here at a conference, at an Unconference. Today I'm going to be talking to you about the digital transformation trends and aligning them with 21st century skills. Now there's no doubt in anyone's mind that digital transformation is changing the way that education is being delivered across classrooms across the world. More importantly though, is the purpose aligned with the way the trends are emerging? In this hot pursuit of the latest in AR, VR, AI, fourth industrial revolution, have we missed the woods for the trees? Now, it's not a question of if, but when, at least some of these technologies will become mainstream across classrooms across the world. But the fundamental question lies is in, are we serving the purpose of 21st century learners? Or are we just finding fancier ways of lesson delivery through e-pedagogues? A course correction is required at a time when these trends are still evolving, when they're still forming, because we can ill afford another education system that prepares students for and tests students in skills that they won't even require in their lifetime. So what are the latest buzzwords in these education conferences that happen all over the world? Latest buzzwords. AR, AI, VR, MR, XR. What is AR? AR? Augmented reality, says Ravi. What about AI? Artificial intelligence. MR, a little tougher. Mixed reality, yeah. So all these great buzzwords, and there are so many schools and government bodies just running behind technology just for the sake of it. In today's parlance, today's kids would call it out of FOMO. What is FOMO? Fear of missing out. That's why a lot of schools are doing it, for the wrong reasons. Now, Finland, known to be one of the top performing education systems of the world, and I'm not one to say that you can parachute all the ideas from a country and put them in another country, but we can learn the best practices. Finland, a country that I've really studied the education system over the last 4 or 5 years, met with the national ministry, sat inside classrooms, spoken to parents, gone to the B.Ed. teacher training colleges. I was speaking to this one principal in a central Finland city called Jyväskylä. Is Bhanu? Bhanu's here somewhere. He was with me on that trip. I was talking to this principal in Jyväskylä, and he's like, I was asking him, you know, how come you guys don't use as much of technology in education as your European peers do? And he's like, you know, Raghav, why should I show my children the different kind of berries on a screen when I can just take them outside and show them in real life? While it was a limited point, his message was loud and clear, that so many are just over-obsessively running behind this technology bandwagon just for tech's sake without understanding its true value and purpose. In this day and age of nomophobia, do you know what nomophobia is? Yes, Mrs. Beer says no mobile phobia. No mobile phobia. You know when you get stressed and anxious when you don't have your mobile around you? Or you know when your battery is at 2%, 3%, how you feel anxious and stressed? When you don't charge your when you put your phone on charging and it doesn't charge in the morning, you get tensed, your day starts badly. Nomophobia, it's a condition where you get anxiety and stress when you don't have your mobile around you. In this day and age when nomophobia has become a condition, and the virtual worlds of children are overshadowing the real worlds. No, can I have my PPT back on screen, please? We have to ensure the balanced usage of technology in education. Is the lesson delivery improving? Is the learning outcome being enhanced? If yes, then let's consider the option of why we want to go ahead with the technology. And furthermore, there has to be a follow-through plan. The management can't just go and give all this technology to a school and expect the school to really do well. Are the teachers bought into that vision? Do they have a buy-in? Is there a teacher development plan? Is there bandwidth associated with that technology that you want to actually implement in your school? What is education? What is the purpose of education? In one word, simply, education is simply about learning. That's all education actually is. Why do parents send their children to schools? So that they can maximize the inherent potential and excel at what they are best in. So what is the role of the educator then in the 21st century? Is it just one of information delivery? No, not really, because in this day and age of Google, we all have infinite amount of information at our fingertips. So the role of the educator in the 21st century has moved from being that sage on the stage to being a guide on the side, from being a gatekeeper, security guard of knowledge, to being a facilitator of learning. That's all what a teacher actually needs to do. I'm going to try to make this a little bit more interactive now because I'm finding the audience a little too cold. Can you tell me what is an endorphin? What are endorphins? It's a neurotransmitter that is released when you feel better and when you exercise. It's a hormone that when you feel happy that is created. It's your feel-good hormone. When your body feels really good and confident about yourself, generally after exercising or running or playing a sport, or even generally, otherwise if you feel really happy, that's an endorphin rush it's called. Okay, a little tougher question. Where is the highest concentration of endorphin receptors found anywhere in the human body? Where in the human body is the highest concentration of endorphin receptors found? Guesses? Eyes? No. Fingertips? No. Sorry? Heart? No. Somebody said brain out there? Yes, brain is the right answer. Since you all got the right answer with brain, let me make it a little tougher. What part of the brain is found finds the highest concentration of endorphin receptors? Which part of the brain? Cerebellum, no. No. Hippocampus. Who said hippocampus? Wonderful. It's the first time I've ever got somebody say the right answer for hippocampus. Hippocampus is the learning centers of your brain. What does that mean? The highest concentration of endorphin receptors, your feel-good chemical, is found in the learning centers of your brain. Our brains are hardwired to want to learn more and to find joy in learning. Now, the way these endorphin receptors are released is like an inverted U-shaped curve, like a bell-shaped curve. What does that mean? That the new knowledge that you're gaining has to be on the periphery of your knowledge base. Let me explain that to you with an example. If I asked you to sit here and stare at a blank white screen for 2 hours, you have to sit and stare at the blank white screen. Or you have an option, you could maybe read something on your phone, read a magazine, or go to the museum. Which one are you going to choose? A or one of the B? You're going to choose one of the latter. Why? Because you're learning something new. Now, okay, let me ask you, how many of y'all checked your Facebook in the last 24 hours? We have about 10 or 20 honest people. The rest of them are not being that honest. Okay, in the last 3 days, how many of y'all have checked your Facebook? There we go, a lot more people. Now, if your Facebook newsfeed was filled with something, the same thing again and again and again and again, would you keep going back to your newsfeed? No, you wouldn't. However, if it was something new, but in a language that you didn't understand, would you still keep going back to your Facebook? You wouldn't. So if it's too distant in your knowledge base, from your periphery of your knowledge base, or too monotonous, it's too much of the same thing that you already know, your endorphin receptors are not going to really trigger up, which is why you don't find the joy of learning anything of that. Yet, a lot of our education systems do exactly that, squeeze out the joy of learning. When our bodies, our brains are created, are hardwired to find joy in learning. I often ask the audiences in my workshops, what do you think is the right mood for a child's brain to be in when entering a lesson? What do you think is the right mood for a child's brain to be in? We have all educators here, a lot of educators, and a lot of children as well. What do you think is the right mood for a child's brain to be in when starting the lesson? Relaxed? Curious? Happy? Curious? The four most common answers that I get are the child should feel happy, child should be positive, child should not be hungry, child should not be sleepy. The right answer is not any of these four. Because if the child is happy, but he's happy because it's his birthday tomorrow and he's going to get a lot of gifts. Or maybe because his favorite cricketer scored a century yesterday. How is that going to make your teaching result in better learning? Nothing. The most important mood for a child's brain to be in is curious, challenged, and purpose. There has to be a purpose to the lesson. Now, what is that purpose? Why are we doing this? Okay, what is the first thing that happens to the children? I'll ask you all this. What's the first thing when you get a test back, your teacher hands you your test back, what's the first thing that happens then? Yeah? Nervousness. Anything else? Yeah? Curious? Yeah? Confidence? Tensed. The typical mood of a child when the test is handed back is, his partner will be like, how much you got, how much you got? First thing you'll do, right? Now a child who does badly in maths, let's say two consecutive exams or three consecutive exams, what does he start believing? You know, maths is not for me. Numbers is not my thing. I'm a failure at maths. Yet the same child will play a video game 15 times at the same level, fail each of those 15 times, but still try for the 16th time. Have you ever heard a child say, video games is not for me? I'm a failure at video games. No child has ever said that. So the purpose, what is the purpose to your lesson? The purpose to your lesson can't be marks. It's much better to say, how would you like to write the next film script? Or maybe write a book one day. Rather than, okay children, take out your books. Today I will teach you how to write a 200 word essay. And for you, that's 3 pages long because you write so big. Why do I want to learn how to write a 200-word essay? I'm in the second standard. I don't even know what an essay means. There's no purpose associated to that lesson. Let's take an example of chemistry. Do we have any chemistry people out here? Nobody? A few? Okay. So what is neutralization? Yes, the little child out there. Wow. Wow, wonderful. When acids and bases come together, you get salt and water, acid plus base equals to salt and water. And how have we been taught this? Everyone write down NaOH plus HCl equals to NaCl plus H2O. And you please check, is the equation balanced? Better memorize this, it's very important for your exam. Purpose, what purpose has been set up? Exam, marks, better mug it up. Let's see what a teacher in Russia did. Essentially, it's a teacher in Russia. And she's trying to build purpose into that lesson and try to make something like neutralization a lot more fun and interesting. So she takes one child volunteer and she takes the knife. If you notice on the video, and I'm going to let the secret out, but since the video is not working, the knife is upside down. She first sanitizes the child's hand, which is actually a part of the equation that she's trying to teach. And then she takes a knife and cuts it. And the child goes, oh my God, and he's fainting and all that. And all these children in the class are like, oh my God, our friend Dimitri is going to faint, and how has our teacher cut his wrist and all. And at the back, you see one of the girls, she's laughing about it. It's a big prank, it's a big scam, because she's holding the knife upside down, and she's basically just showing the equation of what she wanted to teach. Essentially, what are the children really going to remember? What absorption in their brain is going to happen? Remembering it like that, where their friend Dimitri almost fainted with that little prank that the teacher played, or acid plus base equals to salt plus water, you better memorize it, because if you don't, you're not going to get marks. That's not the purpose of education, that's not the purpose of teaching. So it's critical that you have to spark the imagination and inquiry in a student, in their brain, and once you do that, the learning will take place organically. Our brains are hardwired to want to learn more. We are the most curious species that has ever been there in mankind, in life. We want to go to the moon. We want to see what's happening in Mars. We want to know what people are talking about as soon as we leave the staff room. What were they gossiping about me? We are the most curious species ever. So you just have to be able to spark that imagination and inquiry. Now, to the educators here, when you're talking to a child, what are you talking to? What are you talking to? The child's eyes? Ears? Imagination? You're talking to a child's brain. It's a communication between two brains. That's all it is. So how many next slide, please. How many children do you think, when surveyed, enter the right mood before a sporting activity? What percentage of students do you think enter the right mood before a sporting activity? What percentage of students do you think enter the right mood before a sporting activity? 80%? 90? 100? So we've got 80, 90, 100? 85. Okay, thanks. Wonderful. So 80, 85, 90, 100. What about exam or test at school? How many students consciously enter the right mood before an exam or a test at school? 5, 20, 30, 50, 40, 10? And homework at home? Zero. All the kids are saying zero. To all the educators here, listen to the kids. Zero. Anything else? 20? 15? 30? I should have got some prizes to get the right answer or something. I didn't realize there would be that many kids. Anyways, so, okay, let's think, what is the typical mood of a student before they enter an exam? What is the typical mood of students before they enter an exam? Tensed, scared, nervous, anxiety, anxious. What's a typical scene? Miss, 2 minutes, 2 minutes, I'm just doing my revision and entering, right? Now, what is the child going to learn in those last 2 minutes that he didn't learn in the last 2 weeks? Nothing much, nothing really. Yet, what the child has done with this stress, what is the human body's reaction to stress? What does it release? Cortisol. It releases this chemical called cortisol. Now, cortisol goes and floods what is the prefrontal cortex. The prefrontal cortex is the CEO of your body. Why is it the CEO? Because it controls all the executive functioning of your body and the decision making of your body. Now, when it's flooded with cortisol, your prefrontal cortex, you have successfully managed to give yourself a much lower chance to success in that exam than to do well in the exam. So, entering an exam with all that stress is probably the worst thing that can happen for a student. And a lot of parents say, you know, I don't stress my kid. I don't tell the kid anything. I don't tell them that you have to go and do this, otherwise this will not happen. A lot of them still do that. Now, a lot of parents will be like, no, no, we don't do all this, but the mother will go for a fast for 2 days before the exam. There are parents who have seen the pen that the child is going to write with is gone to the big mandir, to the temple, and gone the blessings of God. Now, even though you're not telling your child, oh my God, the exam is everything, be all end all, by doing these things, you are complicitly putting it in the child's brain that, oh my God, if this doesn't happen, it's too big a deal. You need to get the good chemicals like the endorphins and the dopamines into the child's system so the child feels secure, self-assured, confident about themselves. What about homework at home? Typical mood, why? What is the purpose of homework? The purpose of homework is to reinforce the concepts that were learned in class in so that it's better absorption in the brain. Yet, why do children do homework? And this is across the world. I've asked kids in London, I've asked kids in Sydney, I've asked kids in Abu Dhabi. Why are you doing homework? What is the purpose? So that the teacher told me that's why. So that I don't get a scolding. So that I can avoid punishment or a remark. Or, you know, so that I can go and play. Mom said that, you know, if you finish your homework, you can go and play. Why have we made homework into a negative thing? It's like that dialogue from that, what is that movie, Sholay. You know, 50-50 kos dur, jab koi bachcha rota hai, to uski maa kehti hai, beta, so ja, varna homework karna padega. Now, why have you made homework into gabbar? Why have you made homework into a bad word? And then you expect the child to actually gain something from that homework? Even if I force you as an audience to do something that I've made you hate doing, and you do it out of respect or out of fear for me, are you going to gain anything from it? You're not really going to gain much from it in any case. You're just going to be doing it in a perfunctory manner. I'll tell you the results. A sporting activity. To all of you who guessed, okay, yeah, 90 to 100%. 90 to 100% of students are entering the right mood before a sporting activity. Exam or test, that falls down just to 10 to 20%, that's it. And homework at home, 0 to 10%, y'all were right. A study was done by the World Economic Forum with the different countries of the world, and on average per week, how many hours do parents spend with their children doing homework? Where do you think India came in that survey? Somewhere on the top, which means a lot of number of hours, somewhere in the middle, which means middle of compared to other countries, or somewhere lower, means much less than other countries surveyed. First, on the top, lower. The kids, it's interesting, the kids are saying lower and middle, and the educators and the elders are saying more to the top. That's very interesting. That's throwing up new things for analysis. The answer is, India ranked right number one. Right at the top, 12 hours per week is what the average Indian parent spends with their child doing homework. Right at the top. China, somewhere in the middle, at about 7.2. Japan, right at the bottom, 2.6. Really interesting. Now, I'm going to say that I think it's very good if parents spend healthy, active time with their children in their homework, in their schoolwork. It's important that parents play a healthy, active role. However, I will qualify that statement. The quality of that time spent is also extremely important. So the time spent in 12 hours is, you better study, otherwise you will not get into this college. And if you don't get into this college, then your life is doomed. If that is the kind of time that a parent is going to spend with their child, or threatening, or just nagging, then it's not worthy of much. It's not worth much. However, if the time that's spent is actually healthy time, active time, you find those kids tend to hit their developmental milestones faster. And what is this most favorite thing of our Indian and Asian education system? What is it that we are all chasing? Marks, especially now, we're in Jan. Next couple of months, something big is coming up, right? In March, April. We're all chasing marks, tests, scores. Sounds so scary. Now, what are marks? What are tests? Tests are meant to be diagnostic in nature. They're meant to diagnose the strengths and the weaknesses of the child, so the teacher can adjust her lesson delivery accordingly. That's all tests are supposed to be. Yet tests in our country have become a way, a measure, of putting a label on a student. So you got 95, genius. 80, good. 60, average. 40, duffer. Why have we made tests a measure of putting a label on a student? What are tests? Essentially, the marks are just a measure of your memory retention and regurgitation. What marks you get, if you get 90 and you get 75, it tells me that you can memorize better and regurgitate better than you can. But in this day and age of Google, even if you can memorize as much as an encyclopedia, you're not going to know more than Google. Today's kids, by the time they grow up, they are going to be auto-prompted with artificial intelligence and other information that they will require to complete their next task. So why are we valuing and measuring and testing students in memory retention? In the 21st century, the world economy is not going to reward you for how much you know, but for what you can do with what you know. Not for the amount of knowledge that you have, but for how you apply the knowledge that you have. Thank you very much.